C# 11 was released on November 8th along with .NET 7 during the .NET conference, and it came with a lot of performance improvements and new features. And today I will cover two of the new very cool features that were released as a part of C# 11. The first one is generic math support, and the second one is the list pattern. The generic math support is implemented through generic interface and default methods of interface. The default method of interface was something which was introduced in C# 8, and I covered this in one of my previous videos. But as a part of C# 11, now the methods of interface can also be declared as abstract, which was not the case before. To demonstrate the generic math feature, I'll take an example of a simple math problem, which is nothing but adding two numbers. So to demonstrate that, I'm going to create a new method called add. And for this method, I'll just focus on adding two integers number for the time being. So I can declare here int add, and this add method is going to take two integer parameter. Int first and int second. And then next, what I'm going to do is, inside the method, I'll declare a result variable of type int, and I'll set the initial value as 0, and then I'll set the result variable as addition of first and second. And then finally, I'll return the result. Now here, the result variable might seem unnecessary, but it will become interesting when I get to show the C# 11 feature. So now what I can do is, and here I can use this method. So I can say var result is equal to add, 2. And then I can do console.writeLine of result. And let's run this program now. And here we can see 3 as expected. Now, if I just want to change this to a double from an integer, what is going to happen is it's going to start failing because the add takes 2 integer. Now here, I can make this as a generic, but if I make this as a generic, it will cause an issue which we could not solve till C# 10. And let me show you the problem first. So if we do a T here, T, T, and make it as generic of T. Next thing, what is going to happen is, you can see first, this T plus T, the plus operator is not an operand of type T. So that is first problem. And secondly, the result I have to convert in T. And once I convert this to T, we cannot set 0 to T as well. So these are the two problems we need to solve. And this is where exactly the new feature of C# comes into play. And here, what we can do is we can say where T is, I'm going to use this iNumber interface, which is a generic interface where we can pass the type T, and it is part of system.numerics. And now you can see that the error that we are getting as a part of plus, there is no error anymore. And it says that this plus adds two values together to compute their sum. And if we go into the definition of iNumber, you can see that I number is derived from I base number. And I base number is something which implements another interface called I addition operators. And I addition operators is something which implements the plus operator here. And as you can see, this uses an abstract. So now the methods of interface can be abstract as well. And here, this method, you can see it's a virtual one. So these are the new addition for C# 11. And for the 0, what we can do here, this is another thing which you can see is that if we do t dot, we can see a bunch of method which came part of the t now, which was not the case till C sharp 11. And here there is a property called zero, which is nothing but gets the value zero of that type. And once we set this, the error is gone. And now this represents the zero of whatever type is available here, the zero equivalent for that type. Now if I run the application, you will see the result as expected, which is 3.1. We are able to add two double number at this point in time. And if I go here, you can see that by default, it converted the type to double, as this is the generic double implementation. So this is the first feature that I wanted to discuss, which is very interesting. The second feature, and this is, I think, even cooler than this one, is the concept of least pattern. So to demonstrate that, what we can do is, let's say I declare an array of integer, and I declare it as int items. And I can say 1, 2, 3, 4. So I declare 4 items. And now what I can do is, let's say I want to find out if this array contains 1, 2, 3, and 4, all these 4 variable. What I can do is, I can say if items is, and here I can say 1, 2, 3, 4, then console.writeline. Correct. And let me run this. And you can see it is correct. But here if I do a 5, this is not going to print anything because the if statement will not be successful. Similarly, if I say here 1, 2, 3 and underscore, underscore means anything. It can be anything. This is going to again print correct. Now let's say I don't want to worry about what are the numbers. I just want to print the second number here and everything else. And I know it is phone number, let's say. I just want to print the second number. So here what I can do is I can say var second, and here I can print second. And if I run this, it's going to print 2. And you can see it is printing 2. So this is really, really cool. Now, most of the time, you would not know what is the length of an array. I mean, if we knew the length of an array, then we don't have to do all this. We can just use an index, right? So in that case, what we can do is we can just use dot dot, which is basically rest of the array. And now if we run the function, we're going to see the exact same response as before. Now, the other thing we can do is, let's say, we can declare everything as var rest. And here we can do rest, which is nothing but a array. So here we can do string dot join, and here we can give the parameter as comma, and we can join the rest, and we can print it out. So it's going to print out 2, 3, 4, and as expected, it's printing 2, 3, 4. Now let's say we want to find out if the last number is less than 4. So what we can do is we can say last number is less than 4, and we'll print. Here we can say correct. And we know last number is not less than 4, so it should not print anything as expected. But if we make it as less than equal to 4, now it is going to print the correct statement. And you can see it is printing the correct statement. Similarly, we can do, you know, for all the items in the array, we can add conditions like this. Now, the other cool feature that we can do is we can say that, let's say we want to see how many parameters are here. So for the first one, we say, okay, first one, I don't care. And then something in between. And then the last, okay? Let's say this is for last. And we want to find out that what is the length of this parameter, okay? So we want to know if the length of this parameter is 2. So what we can do is, we can do here, as soon as you come here, you see a bunch of option. Is fixed, read only, length, rank, which is the rank of the array, and then sync root is not important. So if we say length, and we can say length is 3, and then correct. Now here, we should not see anything because the length of the middle two number is only 2. Because we had 4, so we have taken first here as underscore, last here as last. And in between, we are checking if the length is 3, but there is only 2 item. But now if we change it to this and run, you can see it is printing out correct as expected. So this is another really interesting way of using the pattern match of a list. And as you can see, there is a lot of thing we can do in terms of pattern match. Starting from finding out a variable, to matching the length, to comparing if something is greater than or less than. For example, we can do here greater than or equal to 1. Length is 2, val last, and here we can print out the last one. So in one sentence, we can show like 3 or 4 features of least pattern match here. And you can see it is printing to 4. So these are the 2 really cool features in my opinion. There are a bunch of other features. Some of them are for convenience and some of them are really useful. But these 2 stands out for me. So I wanted to cover these 2 in today's video. In my next video, I'm going to cover few of the other features of C# 11 and .NET 7. If you like this video, please give me a thumbs up. And if you are new to my channel, and if you think you are getting value out of my channel, please subscribe to my channel. And thanks so much for watching this video.